Okay, hey everyone, and welcome back to Default Global. Here we engage in conversations with entrepreneurs and remote work specialists from all around the world. And today we're thrilled to have Kate Lister, who's the president of Global Workplace Analytics. Kate, we appreciate you being here with us today.
Great to be here.
Absolutely. Kate, it is kind of an honor to have you on our podcast, and you're kind of highly respected expert in the remote work field, right? And with that, could you please share a bit about your background and experience with our listeners?
Sure. I started out as a banker, actually, and then ran several rather unique businesses in between. One was flying vintage airplanes, old World War II and 1920s airplanes doing rides. So that making the connection from that to what I do now is just a very long story. So what I've been doing for the last almost two decades is helping organizations consider and deploy the remote work model. We didn't call it that then. We called it, back then it was telework. But obviously in the last 3 years, I've been doing a lot of helping companies create all of the policies and norms and figure out what to do with their real estate and all of those things that are going on with the return to office effort.
Okay, sounds good. And with your extensive experience in remote work and this global team management, you know, it might give you a kind of unique perspective on the challenges and the opportunities that come with it, right? So one critical aspect of managing distributed teams is building and maintaining trust, especially with different cultural expectations and norms, right? So how do you think organizations, companies can approach this issue?
There's a lot of possibilities. The one of the things that we've preached for 20 years is just how important it is to have cross-cultural teams, to have people working across departments and their own talents and everything. So, you know, what I've been hearing for the last several years is that that's actually playing out. It's like, wow, we couldn't have hired this person if we had not gone remotely. But, you know, then there's the chance that that person is going to be an outsider or feel like an outsider. Mm-hmm. And one of the things that we learned during the pandemic also is that a lot of people felt like outsiders, particularly in online meetings. So, you know, I think one of the things is celebrate the differences. Make sure your team understands the differences. It feels free to talk about it. Respecting time zones. So, you know, having those team norms and agreements, and we can talk more about that in a little bit, but just understanding that there is that issue, and maybe like rotating their meetings so that it's not one group that's always having the meeting at midnight. Being intentional about those connections, both strong ties and weak ties, and you know, putting those people together. Having common interest groups, so games, gardening, food, sports, you know, whatever it is that people can get together and sort of see the other side of them. I mean, that's kind of it. It's creating those social bonds. I had there was some research a few years back about two people walk into a room. It's a controlled study. And one, they don't know each other. And one person is asked to put their hand in a bucket of really hot water, super hot water. And they measure the neurons, the mirror neurons on the other person, the ones that, and nothing fires. They have them go out of the room, spend 10 minutes playing a video game and come back in. And now the mirror neurons fire when the one person puts their hand in the hot water. So, I mean, it doesn't take that much, but just having that shared interest. And stories, I think, play a big role in that, too. You know, having people tell the stories of who they are and where they are and what they care about. I think role play is another good idea. Put yourself in the other person's shoes. You know, do a little debrief of this is how I feel in a meeting, and then have them switch roles. I know one company also that had like a monthly culture day, where everybody would spend a half a day outside doing something that represented their culture, and then bring back photos and post them to a photo board. So it just takes a lot of intentionality. It doesn't just happen when you're in the elevator.
That's true. That's true. That's a great perspective. And building on that, let's talk a bit about creating opportunities for employees to develop these strong ties and weak ties, maybe in the context of global hiring, and maybe in the context of this international teams. Particularly, maybe you have some examples from the tech space. You know, how can companies go about this?
It's a good question, because I'm constantly hearing from leadership that our innovation is suffering because of remote work. Right. Our productivity is down. Our cultural connection is suffering. And did I say productivity already?
I guess you.
But the research shows that every one of those is not true. These leaders feel like their culture is declining, but in fact, it actually went up, the connection to culture during the pandemic, and it's higher for people that are hybrid mm-hmm. or remote than people who are on site. And, you know, I think we used sort of the physical space as a proxy for culture, and right. It wasn't. On the innovation side, people feel more innovative when they're in a group, but it turns out they get more innovative ideas. They're more creative. I mean, creativity is a two-part process, or innovation is a two-part process. It involves creativity, and that's the first part. And we're most creative when we're alone, when we're driving, when we're in the shower, you know, we're walking in nature. And so it takes that element of being alone, mm-hmm. and then best vetted when people are together. So there's two parts to that. And that's not to say that people have to be together to innovative. If there is already trust, that's sort of the fundamental. We also found during the pandemic that global patents went up. So that's sort of against the idea that this is hurting innovation. Venture capital investment went up. So there's lots of evidence to show that, okay, that's not necessarily true. It might mm-hmm. be, but we're not doing a good job of measuring it. We weren't before the pandemic. So how do you measure? Well, one of the things we know is that innovation benefits from cross-culture, like we said earlier. And so measuring, asking, how many people do you know outside your group? How often mm-hmm. do you talk to people outside your group? How often do you talk to people of a different culture, of a different age? You know, all of those things is just one way we can measure it. So, you know, understand if it is a problem before you spend any money on it. It's like there's a lot of things that people are worried about that aren't, in fact, problems. And yet there are a lot of problems that they that are real and that they should be spending their time on. So we also found during the pandemic that, in fact, strong ties got stronger and weak ties got weaker. And that makes sense. You know, you sort of hunker down with your team, those strong ties. And, you know, I think we've sort of been in triage mode for the last 3 years. We're just sort of, we have our head down and we're just trying to get through it. And so it's again about intentionality. You're not going to bump into them on the elevator. So mm-hmm. maybe it's like speed dating, you know, assigned speed dating, that every Wednesday you get together with somebody you don't know virtually or physically. Maybe you're part of your manager's job is to help you get to know people in other disciplines. And actually, instead of speed dating, that's sort of like arranged dating. mm-hmm. Having local get-togethers. So and this happened kind of organically during the pandemic, is that people would say, hey, I didn't know you lived near me. How about we get together? Right. You know, even regional and global get-togethers. It doesn't take a lot of time being together to create those trust bonds and to maintain them is much easier than people think. But it does help to have that in-person presence and to spend that time doing things that are not work, that are social, and create those shared experiences. You know, go out and paint a barn or something that that needs painting, or do some charity work.
Right, right. That's true. That's true. And speaking about measuring, you touched this a bit. What specific metrics companies should implement to make sure that this kind of remote work works for them, you know?
Yeah.
From your point of view.
It depends on what they want from it. You know, if what they're trying to do is, and this is true of most companies right now, is attract and retain talent, then that's what they ought to be measuring.
Let's maybe talk from not from productivity, but from maybe cultural perspective. That from what metrics that they can implement in this area?
How many people, cross-cultural people, do you have on your team? How often do you get together with them? Do you use processes and practices that are cross-cultural friendly? Do you have translation available for your meeting transcripts? Do you celebrate one another's holidays? Do you make asynchronous documents? Do you defer to asynchronous documents so that people all over the world can participate without having to be on there online at 2 a.m?
Okay. And what maybe specifically you can suggest me as a founder of Global First Company? You know, I have like guys in Argentina, Mexico, Brazil, in Ukraine, Poland, in Azerbaijan, Kyrgyzstan, or whatever, you know? So in different continents, different time zones, absolutely different cultures, you know? So what can you suggest, you know, to me as a founder of this Global First Company?
I guess... don't be afraid of it. I think a lot of organizations are afraid to hire somebody, you know, outside of their culture, outside of their geography. You know, look to a specialist who understands those cultures. If you don't have that talent internally, then hire somebody that does have that talent and can do that kind of vetting.
You mean like a sort of HR person, or what kind of specialist?
Yeah, I guess an HR person, but with a global understanding. You know, it's not just your typical HR person.
Okay.
In fact, it might even be a director of culture or a director of workplace experience whose whole job it is to make people feel like they're part of the organization. You know, do the introductions with your team. Get to understand that person. Maybe have, you know, your onboarding, have them describe how they like to work with other people, and, you know, let other people understand that. And, you know, I assume that they're not going to be on site if they're hiring through a company like yours. And so then all of the things that organizations are worried about with remote employees needs to be applied to that. But let's just assume everybody's okay with remote working to begin with.
Okay. And just maybe let's talk a bit about like new employees, right? New team members. And when it comes to welcoming and integrating new employees who are kind of remotely or located on different continents, you know, what are some ways companies can ensure, you know, they feel connected to their teams from the day one?
Yeah, I think even more than important than being connected to the teams is connected to the purpose of the organization. And those two sort of go hand in hand. So, you know, is there alignment in terms of values? So making those values very transparent even before hiring, because something like 50% of people quit in the first 6 months, and it's usually because it turns out to be not a very good fit. So you can save a lot of money and time by just getting the right person to begin with.
That's true.
And then, you know, if you don't already understand that culture, dig in. I'm a big fan of working together agreements that specify things like... you know, attire. What are we going to wear when we're on a video meeting? Is it going to be different if it's a team, if it's within your team, or if it's with a client? Some people in other cultures live in smaller homes, and there's going to be noise in the background. There's going to be children. Having that understanding.
I know that.
Is it okay to eat during a video meeting? Mm-hmm. Do we have to be video on? If it's 2 in the morning, I don't really want to be video on.
Right.
Expectations around things like response time is different across cultures. And so, again, making that part of a working together agreement and setting boundaries. I'm not going to work at 2 in the morning because work-life balance is important no matter where you live. Mm-hmm. Understanding that there's different thinking styles, and this is not just within cultures, but within our personalities. I'm an introvert, for example, and introverts think more slowly than extroverts. So when we're in a meeting and somebody, shoots at you, "What do you think, Kate?" It's troubling for me. And I think the same is true of people that are on calls that are not speaking the native language. It takes them longer to process, and by giving things like closed captioning and transcribing and videoing the meeting and having asynchronous documents so that you don't have to.
That's true. It seems like you are talking about me.
Using in meetings the other tools like emojis and chat. And understanding that not everybody's good at chat and not everybody can multitask across that chat. So having somebody monitor that maybe needs to bring those thoughts that someone was more comfortable putting in chat than saying out loud. Some cultures aren't blurters. They like to think about something before they speak. Right. Extroverts control the meetings because they love to blurt. They love to just, think out loud. praise, how do you like to get praise? Do you want the dancing gorilla? Or would you like me to just, quietly pat you on the back and say that was a really good job bit? Those are just some of the things that I think you need to understand.
And those are some excellent suggestions, I guess. Yeah. In one of your interviews, you also mentioned this critical role managers, team leaders play in enabling remote work, right? So, and I'm just curious, what are some of the significant challenges they face when supporting distributed teams, and how can they address these challenges?
The head of the U.S. General Services Administration back in, it's got to be maybe almost 10 years ago, they were renovating a downtown building, their headquarters, and it was originally designed to hold 2,000 people. They integrated reservation-based seating. Nobody had an assigned seat. They would make reservations for conference rooms and for seating, or they would just drop in. And the difference was it wound up being a building that could accommodate more than 4,000 people. Mm-hmm. But the point of this is that she said, use the word telework. Telework doesn't create management problems. It reveals them. And I think we've seen that very in so many ways across the pandemic. And one of the things it revealed, which we knew all along anyway, was that managers don't manage by results. They're used to managing by the back of a head. If they're in the seat, then they must be productive. Right. It's hardly true given that the highest online shopping time is at lunchtime. So, again, don't take that for granted. And it's not just your remote people you should be worried about. But I mean, the whole thing that is that there should be these cascading goals that come out of the organization's values and start at the top and get showered down. What's the word? Cascaded down to every level so that everybody has a connection to what the company's purpose is and understands it. And more importantly, in terms of virtual teams, that's how they're measured. Did you get the job done, right? Did you meet your goals? And if you did, who cares when or how or where you did it?
100%.
And we know that people work best when they're given that kind of autonomy, when they're trusted to do those things. So manager training is just absolutely essential. I think employee training is essential too, in terms of learning how to manage up and learning how to be visible. So, you know, write a little email at the end of the day to say, hey, I did this, or, you know, whatever you accomplished, or just be visible, because it's so easy to think, I haven't heard from Vit in a while. He must not be working, or he must be unhappy, or, you know, whatever. We make up these stories in our head. Right. And I think that, you know, even something as simple as using a daily check-in with an emoji goes a long way.
Yeah.
So, you know, that's sort of, I think, the big issue with managing remote employees is that, you know, most managers were hired from a position of doing something into a manager without being given training. I think I read a statistic lately that said only 22% of companies offered training for remote work during the pandemic. And it's all those things that we should have been doing all along, you know, making sure the technology is right, making sure that we have communications norms and collaboration norms and team norms and meeting norms, and everybody agrees on these things. You know, giving it structure. In some ways, I feel like, you know, imagine when we got cell phones, we only used them at the house, or when we got smartphones, we only used them to make phone calls. I feel like that's what we've been doing for the last 3 years. We're using old practices and processes to work in new ways. And if we're going to be effective and efficient at working with distributed teams, we need to go back and take a look at all of those practices and processes to see how we can do them better in the virtual world. And, you know, I'm a big fan of remote first, even if you have everybody in the office, because everything that you need to do to prepare for remote is going to make you better prepared to operate wherever you are.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I agree with that. And Kate, considering your observations of various, you know, industries adapting to this flexible work, remote work, what would be your maybe top three pieces of advice you can give to companies or organizations that are, you know, looking to hire globally while maintaining effective collaboration and communication among these remote employees?
I think, as I said earlier, recognize the needs of different personalities and cultures, make it visible, talk about it, take the time to connect individuals at a social level, take, you know, 5 minutes at the beginning of every meeting and do something social, or do, you know, an icebreaker, and make that part of the meeting.
Okay. That's good. And from your point of view, are there any kind of maybe specific industries, maybe specific niches, maybe specific, I don't know, type of companies that simply cannot work remotely? I mean, because of, you know, some pitfalls, obstacles, maybe from your experience, you know such companies.
Well, I mean, certainly, you know, a lot of companies would seem like it's not appropriate. I mean, I could take the whole manufacturing sector, for example, and say, well, they can't. Well, yes, they can, because a lot of the time that, you know, a lot of the people in a manufacturing organization are not on the shop floor. And I think there'll be fewer and fewer people on the shop floor as our virtual technologies improve, and as robotics and as artificial intelligence and virtual reality and all of those things. So there are people that are eligible that that could do some of their work remotely in just about every industry. Healthcare, for example, has a very high component of remote work. So obviously tech is number one. Finance is probably number two. Education, you know, we've proven that can be done remotely. It could be improved. I find certain cultures are not as accepting of remote work because they're more based on that esprit de corps in the room. You know, not to overgeneralize, but I find that France, for example, the French have a very strong in the room culture. You know, we eat together, we play together. You know, it's important for us to be together. And so recognizing that it's going to be different across different geographies, even within the U.S., Texas, for example, has a much higher return to office level than all of the other states. So, you know, there's just something different about Texas. You know, I'm struggling for where it wouldn't work. I mean, obviously, in you know, can't dig a ditch with and being remote, but it's also important that we find some way to be flexible with those, let's call them essential workers or essentially on-site workers. If we were working with a company to help them, you know, structure this before the pandemic, we would have been talking about a whole suite of flexibility, not just flexibility for knowledge workers. So start and end time, job sharing, time off, you know, a lot of things like that can be offered to the people that can't be remote. And, you know, we find that about 20% of the workforce doesn't want to be remote. You know, they want to go somewhere that, where people talk in full sentences, for example.
That's also true.
They want to get away from the house, or they don't have, particularly younger people don't have the kind of place that allows them to do their best. Mm-hmm. Are you hearing a buzz in the background?
Buzz?
Buzz.
I'm not sure.
Okay, if you do, let me know because my robot vacuum cleaner just went off.
Ah, that's fine. No worries.
Okay. What was I saying?
No, I got your point that some of those guys who they still want to go to office and work from there, right? I completely understand this, but from my point of view, companies and organizations in 2023 should give this kind of opportunity to choose, right? Whether you want to go to office or, you know, work from home. For example, myself, I work from home, but also just I have office, and from time to time, just I feel that I need to go there and work for a couple hours from office, you know. It's a question of just you know, of this choice, right?
It's
so companies
choice.
should provide this choice, and that's my perspective on this.
Absolutely. The federal government did a study some years back and found that by offering a choice of where people worked, in great engagement increased even if the people didn't opt to work somewhere else. You know, just having that choice. If you think about when you go out on a Saturday, or, you know, Friday night, you're thinking, oh, thank God, it's the weekend. This is going to be great. But you probably have a lot of errands to do on Saturday. You got to go here and you got to go there and you got to go there. But the difference is that you're in control of that. You make the decisions about when and how you're going to do it. And, you know, the science of this goes back to the 1950s and probably centuries ago. You know, we know that people do their best when they understand the job, understand the goals, have the tools they need to meet those goals, and then are given the autonomy to do it where and when they do best. But, you know, that 30% or 20% that wants to come into the office, or when you want to drop into the office, as you said, we need to have those spaces in the office for private spaces for the people that are working there. Mm-hmm. About 60% of the work that we do is heads down work. And so, you know, for that 20% that's in the office all the time, they need privacy spaces. In fact, the number one thing that would bring people back to the office is privacy. You know, it just went way overboard since the 2007-2008 pandemic, and we were just squeezing people together and expecting them to be productive and collaborative, and it just didn't work.
Yeah, that's true. Kate, I still have a bunch of questions that I want to discuss with you today, but probably we should do this next time. So I really appreciate your time today. I really thank you so much for joining us today and for sharing those valuable insights on remote work and culture and managing this diverse team. So it's been a pleasure having you on the show today. So take care. Thank you very much.
Great to be here. Thanks for having
me. Absolutely. See you.